We will continue on with our study of the letters of Saint Ignatius. Seven letters, and last year when we got finished with our scripture study, we had a few weeks left over, and so we looked at the Didache, and people just thought that was so valuable. And I thought, well, we would do the letters of Saint Ignatius of Antioch. These are the earliest writings we have outside of that which is within the New Testament. And so these are significant historically. And so I think it's worthwhile to study these. Yes?
I have a question relative to last week.
Yeah.
There are a lot of points made about the fact that it is so close and so early. Is there any dispute about the actual time these were written?
Not really.
Or is there any dispute about their authenticity?
Yeah, there's always been dispute. When there always is, when we start looking at and talking about any kind of documents from antiquity, those are always questions that are raised by scholars. So they are put through quite a bit of scrutiny. We also have in the letters of St. Ignatius later editions of it, which clearly there was a lot of other hands got involved and added a lot of material. And that, now we look back and see that as an unfortunate thing, but the people at the time thought it was probably a good idea to do that. But we pretty much have cleared out what those parts are. So what we're getting here is what most scholars believe is authentic, as far as we can go. As far as the dates, we know they're very early, and we also have some historic evidence that it was under the Emperor Trajan that his martyrdom took place. So that can help us date it to the first decade of the second century.
So it's pretty. Most of the scholars agree.
Yeah, and we're looking at very early material. Mm-hmm. You can see that in terms of the theological content, we can see a further development from the New Testament, but not extremely so. So things are still in embryonic form. He's the first and the earliest writer to use the word Catholic in reference to the church. Mm-hmm. So that's where we get Catholicism or the Catholic Church. So he uses that. And so it seems like if you recognize that there are historical developments that move on, this seems like a very early stage in that development. It's definitely post-New Testament, but it certainly predates some of the later writings that we have in the second century. So I don't think I haven't read too much where there's much in the way of disputing the dating of this material. And one of the things that's so astonishing is how similar it reads to the other epistles in the New Testament. Mm-hmm.
Since you mentioned it, he used the word the word Catholic.
Yeah.
But you also mentioned that he was really big on church unity, and that was the job of the bishops.
Yeah.
Is that maybe why he started that thought that, hey, it's one universal church.
Yeah.
You know, we have to keep this unity, and so we have to have a common.
That probably is. So he really becomes, outside of the New Testament, the first writer that really contributes to what we understand as ecclesiology, which is the theology of church. So he's developing on what has already been laid down in some of the documents in the New Testament. In particular, he quotes a lot from the Gospel of Matthew, interestingly enough, which is one of the reasons we believe. We don't really know where the Gospel of Matthew was published. We suspect it either at some stage was of the development of Matthew's Gospel. took place in Palestine or in Antioch of Syria. And one of the reasons, external reasons, we think that it happened in Antioch of Syria was because Ignatius, who's very early, when he quotes Jesus or quotes the Gospels, he's quoting the Gospel of Matthew for the most part. So he was aware and was using Matthew's Gospel probably because it was used in the liturgy of the Antiochian church. Mm-hmm. Historically, he's considered the second bishop of the church in Antioch, which places him very early. The other thing is that he would be considered, some people would say post-apostolic, but I think he would be more closely related to what we call the sub-apostolic. Sub-apostolic generation is the generation that knew the apostles and their contemporaries, but they were the next generation. And people that we would think of would be like Timothy, Titus, Onesimus. John Mark could be, he's kind of like bridges those two generations. So Ignatius would be a part of that sub-apostolic period. Another thing about Ignatius is that the tradition is that he was a pupil or a student of John. Mm-hmm. But not only that, but there's a strong tradition that Peter was at the Church of Antioch, and that the Antiochian bishops, or patriarchs as they later became called, traced their lineage back to Peter in the same way that Rome does, which is interesting. Mm-hmm. So that's when Rome started insisting that it has the chair of Peter and they can trace their apostolic succession to Peter, as if that was a claim to their preeminence. Mm-hmm. The Syriac church or the Syrian church of Antioch would say, well, so do we.
Yeah.
And we're earlier than you. You know, I mean, that's kind of, that never really was a convincing argument for the church of Antioch. Yes?
Ignatius writes explicitly in Greek, I think.
Yeah, he definitely was writing in Greek. And Ignatius is a Greek name. Now, there is a tradition, but we don't know how historic it is. When I say tradition, these are oral stories that we cannot trace back. They were, when they were finally put into writing, it was so many generations after the event, we can only call it a tradition. So we can't rely on it as being the same as documents that were written contemporaneously with the events they record. But the story of Matthew's Gospel where Jesus takes a child and puts him in the center of the group and says, unless you become like a little child, there's an early tradition that child was Ignatius. Now, that could just be apocryphal, pious way of remembering Ignatius. But one of the things that that where Ignatius becomes a bridge to the New Testament is that we have in the collection of New Testament documents the letter of 1 John. And in the letter of 1 John, as well as in the other two epistles, probably 2 John, I don't know if 3 John gets into this, but there are clearly the author of the two epistles of John, which are in the New Testament, is dealing with this thing called docetism. Mm-hmm. And so we see, which was a very early heresy that was existing at the time in the apostolic era. It was very early on that we encounter that. Well, Ignatius is still fighting that battle. Mm-hmm. So this would put him in close proximity to the New Testament writers. So the fact that he would have been of the age where he would have known the original, the first generation apostles, and that because people say that he was ordained by Peter himself. We have the tradition that he was a pupil of John. And then, of course, we have his letters, which bear a close affinity to the New Testament documents. His ecclesiology is further developed. The idea of the apostolic office being divided into the ordained hierarchy of bishop, presbyter, and deacon. Well, in the New Testament, it's sort of unclear. It's like these were names used in the New Testament, but it was unclear the relationship of bishop with presbyters, with deacons. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it appears that the New Testament writers, it's not a settled issue. Mm-hmm. But by the time you get to Ignatius, it's clearly, these are the three offices, they're distinct from one another. And everything emanates from the bishop, everything. So you have a really strong view here, very early in the church, of the importance of bishops in the governance of the church. And that's pretty, to go back to the beginning, to the dawn of the second century and say that bishops were recognized as having apostolic authority, being the successors of the apostles. So this idea wasn't a later medieval idea. It's something that it seems to be at the very beginning, this idea. So we see that. Also, you see a strong emphasis on the divinity of Christ, where in the New Testament, yes, you get a feel, you can point to passages where it's clearly and unmistakably affirming the divinity of Jesus. But you don't get such strong statements, Jesus is God. You don't get a statement like that in the New Testament. But it's usually more implied than explicit. But then you get to St. Ignatius, and he's so explicit about it. And why would he depart so much from his teachers that were the original generation? Mm-hmm. So these things are very important. His writings are extremely important for us to get a glimpse of how the early church understood what the apostles were saying. So I think these are pretty authoritative writings we're looking at.
You mentioned, I think, the Didache was lost and rediscovered. How about these letters?
We've always had these.
Always had these? Okay. Mm-hmm.
They were always referred to, and they've been quoted throughout history by various other Christian writers. So we've always consistently had these.
I wonder why there's a criticism of the Catholic Church, basically, of people saying, well, you just started all this stuff a few hundred years ago.
That's not true. That,
no, but it's a criticism, but if this has always been around, but I guess it's been read it or something. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, this is due to the fact that, and it started with Luther, but it spread to the other reformers. There was a reaction in the Protestant Reformation of the 16th century against the church authority being the Bishop of Rome. So when you discard what was regarded as an absolute established authority within the church, when you discard that, you have to find something else. Mm-hmm. And so what Luther argued and the later Protestant reformers argued, that absolute authority is the Bible, the Old and New Testaments. That becomes the ultimate authority. And so Luther not only rejected the papacy, which I think he had grounds to do that, but he also rejected the ecumenical councils. And he also rejected the church fathers, which Ignatius was around. So as a consequence, I shouldn't say rejected them outright. They had their place in the thinking of the reformers, but they were not indispensable. And so as a result, Protestants tended to devote their attention to the biblical writings, mm-hmm. and develop their theology from that. And they did not, and as a result, to this very day, Protestants typically do not read this stuff.
Right. Did you ever read
the Didache in the Methodist Church? Yeah. We just don't read this stuff, which is really unfortunate. It's more available to Roman Catholics, but a lot of Roman Catholics, well, everything you need is found in the Mass, and yeah. So you know, so there was a lot of this stuff most Christians are completely unaware of, and it's sad because this is rich material, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It just occurred to me that, for example, Catholic parishes. There is in Orange, or actually in the stand in the Diocese of Orange, there's a St. Polycarp parish.
Yeah.
And there's a St. Ignatius of Antioch parish, I think, in Los Angeles.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of those names are recognized in Catholic parishes throughout the country. But probably, you know, St. Cecilia in Tustin is one of the, you know, she's second century.
Yeah.
But probably people knew very little. I mean, it's not like you go to that parish, nobody
really knows who the person is. But it does show, yes, it's part of the early church's recognizing Catholic custom and tradition, Roman Catholic custom and tradition, certainly.
Yeah, at least Roman Catholics would know the names. Oh yeah, I've heard of St. Polycarp. Most Protestants wouldn't know who St. Polycarp is, really.
Right. It's many goldfish.
Many goldfish.
Growing up.
Many carps.
St. Many goldfish. Or St. Many, what do you call it? What's another carp? A name for carp?
Mackerel?
No, it's a bottom feeding fish. It's a carp. There's a
catfish?
Catfish. Many catfish.
Is a polycarp. Many catfish.
So they search a polycarp with bottom feeding fish more than the guy.
Oh, polycarp. Yeah, the name. Yeah.
May I add a little rider to what you were saying? Basically, in my view, the reformers are shoving tradition to the side in favor of claiming that all doctrine and everything you really need to know and believe and the practices you should engage in are found in the biblical text. And the problem with that is that the biblical text that we have demonstrates pretty clearly that early on the polity of the church wasn't fixed. It was different churches in different places had different understandings of what the polity should look like, and they'll use the word elder in one place and they'll use the word bishop in another, and it's not fixed, it's floating, it hasn't been determined yet, and that's in the biblical text. If you're using only the biblical text, then you're not paying any attention at all to what happens by the end of the first century and the beginning of the second century. So they don't honor the history and the tradition as it evolved by the end of the first century, because they're looking at material that was written, you know, 20, 30 years earlier.
Explains why the typical Protestant denominations all have different names for hierarchy. Like,
well,
a deacon in one church could be like an ordained
pastor, or an elder, or we got to be congregational, or we got to be Presbyterian in our polity, or we'll call them bishops, but they're not, but they're, their orders don't depend on apostolic succession. I mean, we get that kind of pluralism. I call it a cauldron of pluralism that just simply existed at the very beginning in the church. And that, I think that's one reason why the idea that Ignatius is saying this is a universal church, the structure of the polity is settled by that point.
Yeah.
That's really interesting.
Yeah. Now, one of the things that he makes reference to, and we'll see this again in the other epistles that we will read the text to, is the idea of docetism. So he doesn't himself use that, but he makes reference to their basic belief. And so I was asking Diane, where does docetism come from? I just presumed it came out of Greek philosophy. But she said not necessarily that. So anyway, you have an explanation here, and this would be great.
Some of it comes from what I did in that adult forum, but just a review. Plato is super important for the history of the Christian church. Plato has this intelligible realm where everything that's important is known through the use of reason, and that includes the forms and ideas. And the intelligible realm is completely separate from the material world around us. Everybody okay on that? So it's the really real. It's known through reason, and it contains the forms and ideas. And the material world that's known through sense experience, it's real, but it's not as real as the intelligible realm. So I just wrote up here, it's a copy of the really real. It's less real, okay? It's just copies. Like this table is a copy of table itself.
But it's not an illusion.
It's not an illusion. Yeah, it has some degree of reality. Okay. So then I put, we haven't talked about Aristotle in those adult forms yet. But Aristotle denies the reality of the realm of forms. He doesn't think that there's a separate realm of forms or ideas. He thinks that the forms exist in the material world, and he basically has two things going on in the material world, but they can only be known through the acts of the imagination. So we really have forms in the material world, and there's matter in the material world, and what the forms do is they organize matter. So a chair is a chair because it has the form of chair, but that's right here in this world. It's not off someplace else. So the material, so for Aristotle, and this is going to be super important as we move down through 1300 years of Aristotle influencing the Christian church, the material world is the real world. And it's made out of form plus matter. But you can't separate the form out. It's what organizes matter. And he calls, when it comes to living things, he calls the form of something its soul. So I'll get more into that later on down the road with the adult form. So I wiggled my nose last week when Bishop Peter tried to blame Greek philosophy for Docetism. So I went and did a little hunting, and the truth of the matter is nobody really definitively knows where Docetism comes from, which is the idea that the material world is basically illusory and it's evil. The illusory part of it most probably came over the Silk Road and is tied to Hinduism and Buddhism. Mm-hmm. So in Hinduism and Buddhism, and this is wild generalizations now, I'm not really going to separate the two religions from each other, the real is something called the absolute, and what I didn't put on the board, but I'll do it right now, is whatever is really real is not known, it's not going to be known through the use of reason, it's not going to be known through the use of sense experience. However we get to it, it's known through intuition. Okay, if we're going to give it a name for what kind of faculty is responsible for us finally tuning in to what's really real, it's going to be, it can't be through the use of reason, that's going to cause us trouble. The physical world, that's not really real either, and so using sense experience, that's just going to cause trouble. Whatever is finally, ultimately absolute, nirvana, whatever name you give it, the way you're going to get to know it is something other than reason or sense experience. And the only word we really have in English to try to hit that would be it's some sort of intuitive grasping, like in Zen, the notion of Satori, a flash of insight that lets us know what's really real. Okay, so the bottom line here is that over in these two religions, the world we know through sense experience is an illusion. And that's what Docetism says to us. It seems that Jesus was a real human being, but he couldn't possibly have been a real human being. It just seemed like he was.
And the reason why he couldn't possibly be a real human being
is because this world is an illusion. Okay, what we're actually experiencing is an illusion.
And matter is evil.
And then we have to work in there, matter is evil, and the Gnostics, of course. And we also don't know the exact origin of where Gnosticism comes from either, but so you add on the world is an illusion and the world of matter is also evil. And there we are. And so Yahweh, who creates the physical world, is not the highest God. And all of that you've got to let go of if you're ever going to get to what's really real. Well, that's going on in Docetism. And the weirdness of it, I think, is that what they use is interpretation of that. You get Docetism from a weird interpretation of the first part of the Gospel of John.
So really, docetism ultimately is a denial of incarnation.
Oh, absolutely.
Which is at the very heart of the Christian mystery.
It is, but the other part of it that is so difficult in the middle of all of this is that if as we're reading Ignatius and he is emphasizing that Jesus was God, it's only a little tiny teensy step over Jesus was God and his human manifestation is an illusion.
What Ignatius attempts to do is to affirm that Jesus is God, but that also Jesus is a man of flesh and blood.
Yeah, and so eventually,
and that becomes the basis of
the two natures,
which later becomes, we affirm that Jesus is fully divine and fully human. And we have to affirm both, and we cannot reconcile that, so it's a paradox.
But that sounds like that gives testimony to the fact that he was fully man, or at least then what became flesh.
Yeah. So they have to interpret that in such a radical way in order to deny that.
Okay.
Yeah. But that's what they're going to. If you're looking for, well, where do they get that? And a lot of people will say that the Gospel of John is the closest, you know, in the march towards docetism. It's the gospel that's the closest. The other thing I wanted to say is that some of the gospels that were discovered with the Nag Hammadi manuscripts in Egypt in 1946 or so, like the Gospel of Peter and the Gospel of Mary Magdalene and the Gospel of Judas and the Gospel of Thomas and all of those, in one of them, and I can't tell you off the top of my head which one, because I've forgotten over the years, has their own view of what happens at the crucifixion. And in this particular form of docetism, what happens is that the divine Christ has taken on Jesus' body. So he became flesh when he took on Jesus' body. And then at the time of their crucifixion, as Jesus goes up onto the cross, the divine Christ separates himself, because of course a God cannot suffer. Mm-hmm. See, that's part of this. Separates from the Jesus that he had inhabited, the fleshly Jesus, and hovers above the cross laughing. Laughing because the disciples think that he's really suffering and he couldn't possibly suffer because he's not really a human being. And there's a book that was written about this particular set of passages in its Gnostic writings, and it's called The Laughing Savior. And that's where it comes from.
You know, one of the strange things is we as moderns have a real difficulty accepting the divinity of Jesus. You know, we have no problem as moderns affirming his humanity, but his divinity becomes something that's difficult for moderns. Quite the opposite from the ancients. The ancients had no problem accepting him as a divine person of some sort, but they have a real problem accepting him as being a human being.
Yeah, that's exactly.
A material thing. It's just kind of funny how much there has been a shift in our mindset from the ancient world.
That's why some of the New Testament passages, for example, the Doubting Thomas story, you know, he's got to touch him, I want to touch the wounds in your hands, and touch, you know, your side where you were pierced. But the punchline of that story is, blessed is he who has not seen and yet believed. As they're moving on down past the first generation of Christians who were direct witnesses to all of this. So, but docetism was right in there kicking at the very, very beginning of the story of who was Jesus. That's right there. But we think, and I'm inclined to believe that it doesn't come from Platonic roots or Aristotelian roots. This idea that the world is an illusion and that you can't get to the real truth through the world at all goes back to Buddhist missionaries come marching across on the Silk Road.
Well, thank you, Diane, for that. That is helpful to us in our present study. Now we're going to get to the, look at another. This will be the second epistle that we will look at. Yeah.
Not to labor this, but just to the east of, you know, where Persia was, wasn't Zoroastrianism a big religion?
Yeah.
Well, that was the religion of Persia.
Persia. Could that have influenced it also? Do they have that kind of
an antimatter?
Right.
I don't know. I don't know enough about Zoroastrianism to tell you.
Their claim to fame is that there's a god of good and a god of evil.
Oh,
that's their main claim to fame.
Yeah.
It's ultimate dualism.
Yeah. It's so evil is created by this evil god,
mm-hmm.
Angra-Manu, and also known as Ahriman. And so that's where evil comes from. But that's
different deal.
That's different. A little different read on the issue of the material world.
Thanks.
So let us look at the letter of Ignatius to the Smyrnians. Smyrna was probably, I would say, it is a major Greek city in what is today Turkey. It's called Izmir now. It's north of Ephesus. I would say that probably it's about 45 to 50 miles north of Ephesus. Do you have that one?
Oh.
Smyrnians, the letter.
Yeah,
the text.
Sure,
good. So let's look at that. The introduction, written by Ignatius. Ignatius, who was also Theophorus. Theophorus means someone who carries God. So that could be a religious name that he took on, or it could be just the way he refers to himself, but he is the God-bearer. This is how he identifies himself in all of the epistles. And now, in the typical fashion of writing letters, of course, you begin your letter by saying who is it coming from, which I think is much more practical than the way we now write letters, where you have to look at the bottom of the page to see who wrote, is writing to you.
This
tells you up front.
This is the interoffice memo, and it's from Mike to...
Oh, they do that now, so they're restoring the ancient practice. Okay, so Ignatius, who is Theophorus, to the Church of God, the Father, and of Jesus Christ, the Beloved, which has been mercifully endowed with every grace, being filled with faith and love, and lacking in no grace, most reverend and bearing holy treasures, to the Church which is in Smyrna. Boy, that's kind of quite a mouthful of how he's describing the community in Smyrna, of Asia. In a blameless spirit and in the word of God, abundant greeting. So he greets them. And you can see the similarity to the letters of Paul in the way he addresses this church. Chapter 1, verse 1, I give glory to Jesus Christ, the God who bestowed such wisdom upon you. See, there's no hesitation to refer to Jesus as God. It's very explicit. For I have perceived that ye are established in faith, immovable. When you see the old English word ye, that is the second person plural. Now we've dropped ye and we just say you. And the context tells you whether I'm addressing you as a group or I'm addressing you as an individual. Context will do that. But our language was a little bit more precise at one time where it was ye and ye all. You've heard that.
Yeah.
And interestingly enough, even though throughout the English-speaking world, ye has been dropped, or ye all has been dropped, it still exists in the southern United States as y'all.
How about that?
Ye all, is what they mean. So they're referring to a group, they're not referring to an individual. So anyway, I just left that translation, the translator's text there, rather than changing it. So perceive that ye are established in faith, immovable, being, as it were, nailed on the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, in flesh and spirit. Notice how he makes this emphasis, flesh and spirit. So implied in that is he's again, that is understood in the background of Docetism, which was clearly a problem in the early church. So he emphasizes Jesus is revealed in flesh and in spirit and firmly grounded in love in the blood of Christ, fully persuaded as touching our Lord that he is truly of the lineage of David according to the flesh. And here he's quoting Paul's epistle to the Romans when he says that. But Son of God by the divine will and power, truly born of a virgin and baptized by John, that all righteousness might be fulfilled, which is a quote from Matthew's gospel by him. Truly nailed up in the flesh for our sakes under Pontius Pilate and Herod the Tetrarch. So here he is, he's really emphasizing this is not an illusion. He didn't just seem to be crucified, he really was in the flesh. Of which fruit we are, that is, of his most blessed passion, referring to the suffering of Jesus and the death of Jesus, the Paschal mystery, that he might set up an ensign unto all the ages through his resurrection, for his saints and faithful people, whether among Jews or among Gentiles, in one body of his church. You notice the emphasis on his ecclesiology, the one body. So we don't have two different churches, we only have one church, one body of Christ. Chapter 2, for he suffered all these things for our sake, that is, he's referring to the passion of Jesus, that we might be saved. And he suffered truly, not in an illusory. He didn't seem to suffer, he really suffered. So you can see it's important for us to realize, have an understanding of Docetism, because it explains why he's using this language and insisting upon this. And he raised himself truly, not as certain unbelievers say, that he suffered in semblance.
Yep, that's the Latin figure stuff.
Being themselves mere semblance, and according as their opinions are, so shall it happen to them. For they are without body and demon-like. So he's saying, you're the illusion, you guys who teach this. I think that's kind of sarcastic there.
Well, you can really see what the issue is when you know what it was that he was writing against.
Yes. See, this is why the historical context of any ancient writing is really important for us. Then, otherwise, we'd be reading this, and if we didn't know about Docetism, we wouldn't, why is he...
What's he getting at?
Yeah, here, why is he going to all this trouble to emphasize these things? Chapter 3, verse 1, for I know and believe that he was in the flesh, even after the resurrection. So he was incarnate. You could even translate it into Latin. Probably that's what it would be. So notice how he emphasizes that. And here, there were some people who would say, okay, he was in the flesh when he lived the earthly life. This is probably one of the compromises with Docetism. But when he was resurrected a spirit. And so there was this denial of the bodily resurrection. Mm-hmm. By the way, he's making an emphasis. He was not only in the flesh before he suffered, he was not only in the flesh when he suffered and died, but he was also in the flesh. His body was raised from the dead. It's a glorified body, it's a spiritualized body, but it's still matter. Mm-hmm. And it's not just an illusion or a phantom or a spirit only in the resurrection. There is a Christian-derived group to this day, and it might be others, but the one I'm aware of are the Jehovah's Witnesses. Jesus did not physically rise from the dead. His body was destroyed, and he's just a spirit that raised from the dead. Jehovah's Witnesses will argue about this with you at your front door. My advice to you is don't ever argue with a Jehovah's Witness. And in verse 2 of chapter 3, and when he came to Peter and his company, he said to them, lay hold and handle me and see that I am not a demon without body. And he's using the word demon much like Plato was using the word demon. He's not thinking of demon in the sense of an evil fallen angel. He's thinking of a spirit. Mm-hmm. A spirit without body. And there he's quoting what appears to be in Luke's gospel. Remember that in Luke's account of the resurrection, Jesus appears in the upper room and they're afraid because they think they're seeing a ghost. Then he goes over, he asks them to feed him, and he eats a piece of fish. Mm-hmm. And he says, this is where he says, touch me and handle me because I am have a body of flesh and bone. And straightway they touch.
I'm wondering if the Greek is daemon there, that they have translated as demon.
Yeah,
I'll bet you anything.
Yeah, I would have to look at that, but I bet you it is.
And he doesn't have any of the connotations of evil demon that we have now.
Yeah, we now, when we hear the word demon, we're thinking specifically of what the New Testament calls an unclean spirit. Mm-hmm. But demon was a more of a generic word that referred to any kind of spirit. Mm.
Okay. Socrates had a demon.
Yeah, it's...
D-A-I-M-N.
Yeah, it would be kind of... In Greek, it would be... which would be, in English letters. Yeah, Bible. Yeah. And then we translate that. Demon. That's where we get the word demon.
Yep.
And of course, demon is, in our usage, specifically an evil spirit. Okay. But not how Ignatius is using the word here. So it's a little confusing. If I were to be translating it, I would just say spirit. And straightway they touched him, and they believed, being joined into his flesh and blood. Wherefore also they despised death, nay, they were found superior to death. And after his resurrection, he both ate with them and drank with them as one in the flesh, though spiritually he was united with the Father. So he's affirming that Jesus is a being of both body, flesh, and spirit. So he's affirming both the divinity and the humanity of Jesus. So, any thoughts about that? Yeah.
What does he say when he says, wherefore also they despise death, nay, they were found superior to death?
In other words, now I'm giving you Peter Hickman's interpretation, but the way I read it is that that they were not afraid of death. Wherefore they also despised death. In other words, it's being fearless in the face of death. And in fact, death could not stop them because ultimately, in their martyrdom, they were superior to death. So death, it was seen as a crowning glory rather than as their defeat. That's how I would interpret it. But what do you think? Ned, do you see something else there?
No, it just seems like very awkward. Maybe it's the translation of something, but I couldn't figure out. I really couldn't interpret. But
yeah.
You know, something you said did trigger some thought that, all Easter hymns include death has been destroyed.
Yes.
Death, all different phrases await.
Where is thy victory?
Where death? Where is thy victory? And so maybe that's sort of the thought that in their recognition of Jesus being alive, all of a sudden death is not to be feared.
That, yeah.
And so they say they were found. Well, it's almost like when I think about it, almost like saying, they've gone from a fear of death into a non-fear of death.
Yeah.
Because it's only of a bodily death.
That's how I would read that, Ned. And I think also when he says they were found superior to death, we think of death as a contest that we always lose. But in this case, they didn't lose, even though they died. But really, when they struggle with death, they actually enter into a greater kind of life.
Well, because they've been incorporated into Christ.
Yeah. It's always connected to the death of Jesus. Yeah. It's always, if we die with Christ, then we shall also live with him. Yeah. Verse 3, and after his resurrection, he both ate with them and drank with them. Oh, I already read that. Okay. Any more questions on chapter 3? We'll move on to chapter 4, verse 1. But these things I warn you, dearly beloved, knowing that ye yourselves are so minded. Albeit I watch over you betimes to protect you from wild beasts in human form. Now, there's an irony here that we might get lost on, so I want to remind you. He has been condemned to death. And the death he was condemned to was that he was going to be thrown to wild animals and torn apart. So now, there's a little bit of irony when he says to them, and he's speaking metaphorically, I want to protect you from wild beasts in human form. He'll use this kind of imagery a lot. Men whom not only should ye not receive, but if it were possible, not so much as meet them. These are people you should only meet. Only pray for them. So you could still be charitable by praying for them, but stay out of their company. If haply they may repent. This indeed is difficult, but Jesus Christ, our true life, has power over it. And here he's referring to these false teachers teaching docetism, basically. For if these things were done by our Lord in semblance, he's going back to the problem of docetism, then am I also a prisoner in semblance? I only seem to be a prisoner. I only seem to have chains around me. Okay. And why then have I delivered myself over to death, unto fire, unto sword, unto wild beasts? But near to the sword, near to God, in company with wild beasts, in company with God. Only let it be in the name of Jesus Christ, so that we may suffer together with him. I endure all things, seeing that he himself enables me, who is perfect man. Who is the one who is perfect man who enables him? Christ. Anything that stands out to you in this chapter?
It's amazing the faith these people have. They're anticipating their own death like this.
Yeah.
Oh. I mean, being ripped apart by animals cannot be a fun way to die.
Yeah.
Well,
we probably won't get to it tonight, but we have the letter to the Romans I gave you tonight from Ignatius.
Yeah.
And he really develops this in the most graphic way. I mean, you read it and you think, he either has a lot of faith or he's totally nuts.
I'm sure you have to work yourself up, huh?
He's something. He's a very vivid writer. Do you notice that?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, we are at chapter 5, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, verse 1. But certain persons ignorantly deny him, or rather have been denied by him, being advocates of death rather than of the truth. And they have not been persuaded by the prophecies, nor by the law of Moses, which is the Torah, nay, nor even to this very hour by the gospel, nor by the sufferings of each of us severally. So he's referring to unbelievers who were not convinced by anything. Verse 2, for they are of the same mind also concerning us. For what profit is it to me if a man praises me but blasphemes my Lord, not confessing that he was a bearer of flesh? So again, he is affirming the incarnation and he is objecting. This must have been a big problem, docetism.
Yeah.
He's obsessed with this.
The docetists thought that all of these Christians that were going ahead and becoming martyrs, that they were the ones that were nuts. Because as docetists, they believed that they were spiritual beings. Their body wasn't really anything at all.
Yeah.
And that they were going to be, they're going to use the same language. They're going to be lifted up to be one with Christ. But this has absolutely nothing to do with the idea of a physical resurrection at all. So they're using the same vocabulary. It means something totally different. You can imagine how confusing this would get to someone who's just trying to learn about Christianity back then. But the folks that were in this other frame of reference really thought that these folks that were allowing themselves to be martyred were just nuts. And so this phrase that the church grew on the blood of the martyrs, I mean, to the docetists, this is just absurd because guess what?
Yeah.
Your body is an illusion. So how can we possibly really be building the church on the blood of martyrs when the whole idea of being flesh and blood isn't really real?
Also, another thing that we see here is that Ignatius obviously feels very strongly about that, but he considers those that would deny that Jesus had a body of flesh and blood were committing blasphemy. To deny the incarnation of Jesus as being truly, fully human and having a human body is, in fact, an act of blasphemy. So you can see he's starting to use extreme language with regard to this. This is not just a difference of theological point of view, even though it is that, it's more than that. It's a very threat to the gospel itself.
Yeah, and I can't reiterate any more strongly than what you do that for us, the hard part is, was Jesus God, not was he human? You know what?
Yeah.
You just have to turn that whole way of thinking upside down in order to really understand the depth of what's going on here.
Yeah. Yet he that affirms not this, and what he means by if you do not affirm the incarnation, does thereby deny him altogether, being himself a bearer of a corpse. So, again, he's using this kind of language back on them. But he really is saying that if you deny the incarnation, you're denying the person of Christ. But their names, being unbelievers, I have not thought fit to record in writing. Too bad, because we wanted to know who those guys were. Nay, far be it from me even to remember them until they repent and return to the passion, that is the suffering, which is our resurrection. Powerful.
He seems to have a little spirit of Paul in him.
Oh,
you know, kind of like,
you can see the echoes of Paul in him,
Just the way, even in the style, the way of speech, you know.
That's
just
interesting.
I'm just talking about in terms of personality and, you know, Paul gives a good licking every now and then.
Yeah.
You know, some sarcasm and stuff.
That's interesting that you see that coming through the text.
Yeah.
You get a feeling, he feels strongly about this issue. he's not being too charitable. But this probably would suggest that when he was bishop in Antioch, this was a constant battle.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And people have all kinds of ideas in the church, you know. Some good ideas, some bad ideas, some harmless ideas. But people have various opinions, and it changes from generation to generation as to what those would be. But there are certain things that actually become a threat to the very message that we're trying to speak of. And Ignatius clearly identifies denying the incarnation of God in Jesus Christ. It is destroying the gospel itself. That's the essence of the gospel, which is interesting.
Can I make a
little
comment?
Yes, go ahead.
Once in a while you'll use the phrase, Jesus suffers with us and we suffer with Jesus.
Yeah.
And I think that idea is one that is so critical to coming to grips with what it really means to be a Christian. And this is not something you ever hear being forwarded as a meaningful idea in, say, the prosperity gospel.
Yeah.
I mean, there is a depth to all of this that is, it's a huge mystery, but it's hugely important in understanding what our Christian walk is really all about. And he's on it.
Yeah. And in fact, he does have a theology of suffering, as we will see, especially when we read his letter to the Romans. I mean, Ignatius has a letter to the Romans, and you're going to see this idea of redemptive suffering. That ultimately Jesus delivers us from all suffering. But in the meantime, our suffering now, particularly if it's suffering caused by our living a faithful life to the gospel, our suffering becomes joined to the suffering of Jesus. So we participate with Jesus' suffering through our own suffering. So we are actually participating in the act of redemption.
Yeah, redemption.
Our suffering is joined. So our suffering is now sanctified in Christ, and it's elevated. It's not just meaningless. Hmm. It is redemptive. And this idea is very strong in Ignatius. It starts with Paul, and then it continues to develop throughout the centuries. But it's one of those things that you don't hear about in Protestantism. You know, the emphasis on Jesus suffered for us, because mm-hmm. he's the only one worthy of doing that. But our suffering, it has nothing to do with redemption. But clearly, that idea has been preserved in Catholicism. Mm. So we recognize that our suffering somehow can be offered up and joined to the suffering of Christ. And I know it gets a little foolish. You probably have some, just offer it up. When people start complaining about the suffering, then the response is, what is it?
Offer it up. I mean, this is, you know, as a cradle Catholic, this was, your mother said it to you, your teacher said it to you. It was a way of saying, well, sometimes it was said in a reverent way, but often sometimes it was like a way of saying, suck it up.
Yeah, exactly.
Suck it up.
Life is tough, you are, and then the teachers would explain this, that you can offer it up, and it would be part of taking on Jesus's burden.
Yeah.
And you feel a little bit better about it. And it was also a way of saying, stop being sorry for yourself.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Life is hard, but you know what? We're all going to get through it, and we're all participating in it.
Yeah.
And so offer it up. But so yeah, offer it up was in, you know, Catholic boyhood or girlhood.
You heard that a lot.
I don't know. I mean, I'm having a hard time here because I do not believe that. I'm a little more into Docetism than I realize. I do believe this is all an illusion, and I have a whole philosophy on it. But I think that I don't. What happens with the suffering part of it for me is that so many Catholics get so caught up in the suffering.
Yes.
They don't see how beautiful and wonderful they are. You know, people that grovel before God because they have to. I think as Christians, people got caught up so much in the crucifixion and the cross rather than the resurrection.
Yeah.
So I have constantly put my focus on the resurrection, so suffering to me isn't even necessary. I truly believe that. And I've gotten to myself to that point where, because I've seen how people take it so much and are just destroying themselves. They just destroy themselves. You know, Mariah's family's like that. Her dad is like one of those, what do you call it, Opus Dei kind of people.
Yeah.
I mean, and where to the point where he won't go to the doctor because he thinks the suffering that he has is important. And it's sad.
Yeah,
it's
so he won't take aspirin if he has a headache.
No, he will not get a shot in his gums for the pain to get a tooth pulled. He will go to the dentist and they will pull his teeth, but he refuses the pain medicine. And it's like, wow.
Yeah, I think that's kind of a misapplication of what Ignatius is saying here. But some people would seek out suffering because they think it's redemptive. Well, if suffering's redemptive,
Jesus already
I will
did
deliver
that
it.
And in
the Middle Ages, they would...
Oh, the flagellation.
The flagellation is the idea. Here, if suffering's that valuable, I'll suffer.
So, Jesus did that for us already, so we don't have to do it. That's
right.
What I believe.
Yeah.
And I don't know where I got that. I just, over time, I just started thinking for myself because, you know, I saw so much of that being Catholic and being raised in the church.
Yeah.
And the beauty of the resurrection is so powerful. It's like that's where I want to keep my focus, really.
Yeah.
I mean, that's truly, and I have to live my life out of that because I've seen too much of getting caught up in the suffering and the sacrifice that people make. And it's almost that's where their focus is rather than on our divinity.
Yeah.
You know, so. I mean, I you know, when I say Docetism, I'm just saying that I do think there is a reality, but it's, the reality is that we've never left God. That's my true belief.
Yeah.
That we are always in the constant and beautiful realm of God, and this is just, you know, lesson, we're learning lessons in this life, you know,
It's interesting that you're saying this, Adelia, because both Roman Catholicism and Protestant Christianity put a lot more emphasis on the suffering and death of Jesus. The Greeks and the Russians and the Syrians, they put the emphasis on the resurrection. The resurrection is what really matters.
I mean, that changes everything.
It does.
It absolutely changes everything. It's like, wow, it's like I get so excited about that.
Well, the Greeks will criticize both Catholics and Protestants and say, what you have done in the Western Church, which is both, both Protestants and Roman Catholics are heirs of the Latin Church, is that you've made Christianity a legal system. It's very legalistic. And that you think of, and this is where you get the idea that the cross and suffering of Jesus, that he is paying a fine that we couldn't afford to pay, you know, that sort of thing. And that the Greeks don't accept that, along with the idea of original sin. These things, the Greeks are thinking about the resurrection changes everything. And it's about the power of the resurrection is what saves us.
I don't know where I came up with that.
It sounds very Greek to me.
Maybe I am a little
Greek. Yeah, there you go. You're a closet Greek.
If you ever want to read a book that gets into these issues in a big way, Dorothy Zola, which is spelled S-O-E-L-L-E, Dorothy Zola wrote a book that's simply titled Suffering. And one of the many things that are going on in that book, but one of the book, a part of the book, has to do with attitudes of people that were in the middle of those prisons and during the Holocaust, and how it just was decimating to hundreds and hundreds of people, and it became transformative to others.
Kind of like Viktor Frankl's book,
Man's Search for Meaning. So anyway, I was introduced to that book a very, very long time ago, but I really think it's just excellent.
Well, I'd like to read that. I've not read that one.
Yeah.
And there's another pragmatic one, more practical, written by a priest. I can't remember his name, but the title is just exactly what we're talking about. Get off the cross, I need the wood.
That's the title, Get Off the Cross, I Need the Wood.
Yeah. Oh, that's great.
What a title!
The hierarchy of the church took advantage of the people by putting that emphasis on the suffering. You know, so, you know, the people would grovel and they would do everything they were told, and they would, and then when the penance time came, you know, you put all this money out, you know, because then that's how you paid your way through this. It was horribly abused, you know, and it's difficult for me to even, you know, I've gone so far in the other direction. I should disappear. No, I'm just kidding.
Where'd you go? Do you leave any footprints behind when you walk?
Yeah, I don't know. But I mean, I love talking about this stuff, though. It's fascinating to me.
Well, but don't you think that part of the attitude that you've taken is because of how you were inculcated as a child, as a cradle Catholic? I mean, a number of us are coming at being Catholic from out of a Protestant background, and we don't carry that particular baggage with us because we didn't get that particular read on the faith at all. Coming,
well, not all of us did. I mean, I didn't grow up with it, thinking that, you know, there was this vengeful God and that Jesus came in and stopped him, and we had to, you know, I remember one of the things that, you know, one of our cultural things in the last 10 years. When did the big Mel Gibson movie come out?
About 10 years ago, The Passion of the Christ.
That really opened up a lot of discussion.
Oh, that was painful. Yes.
And one thing about that is, like, the people who I knew that loved it loved the idea, or seemed to like the idea, that connection to that, and I heard this from a pastor and some priests who really said it, and said, that's not what the Father is about. He wasn't demanding some sort of sacrifice to, to fill a debt of sin. That's just crazy. And so they really objected to that movie about how it emphasized the pain and the suffering, but not the redemptive, the resurrection.
Exactly.
They were saying, folks, I mean, I heard this in some homily. They didn't want to say it too explicitly. We saw a lot of people about the Father of Love. Wasn't that a great movie?
Yeah.
No, theologically, that is not good. That's not a good Christian movie.
Wow.
Because it is putting Jesus in the wrong relationship with his Father.
Yeah.
And you really got to look at, the risen Christ, like you were saying. I mean, that was really in there. But I don't know where that, but there is this tension between some Catholics and other Catholics, and I guess it's between some Christians and others.
Yeah,
because about the interpretation of crucifixion and the death of Jesus, and what it really meant. There's some theological names for this guy.
There's different points of view.
There's two theories of it.
Yeah, there's the satisfaction theory, you're referring to. And that's a very Western Christian idea. In other words, that idea is strong among both Catholics and Protestants.
Right.
The Greeks don't buy into that understanding. But it's very strong in Western Christianity.
Well, in the Catholic Church among theologians, there is also
and
it's sort of a liberal versus conservative.
And it does exist among Protestants. It's like it parallels what's going on in Protestant churches, because there's that constant. There are Protestants who would say, no, it's not that satisfaction idea, and then there are those who would to really insist upon it. But it's interesting. Yeah, Mike.
The counterpoint to your argument, I think, about the film, is that in the evangelical world, there's such a de-emphasis on what actually happened during the crucifixion, and everything is all about a risen Lord all the time, and all the good warm fuzzies, is that people forget he actually did suffer for you, or he actually went through this process, because it's highly de-emphasized in most of Protestantism these days.
Yeah. I heard people who say that you look at, there's the crucifix or the cross.
Oh,
you always can tell you're a Catholic because of
the
body.
The
corpus on the cross, which is very Catholic. I mean,
a
cross without a keys is, could be anything. It could be, doesn't really mean anything.
But you walk
through
a lot
they're celebrating the risen Christ, so there is no body on the cross.
A lot of Protestant,
that's why there's no body on the
churches. You walk in and there's just a cross. It's the risen, it's the symbol of the risen Lord.
That's really typical.
Like that one.
Well, you know what? In Roman Catholic churches over the last 40 years, many of them have de-emphasized the crucifix. Okay? There has to be in there. By canon law, there has to be a crucifix
somewhere.
In the church.
Somewhere,
and it has to be in a prominent place. But it doesn't necessarily have to be on the altar.
Yeah, like behind you or something?
The biggest controversy I remember for years and years at our parish was when the parish was redesigned, there was in back of the altar was a very beautiful, crafted by a guy who worked in wood, and he created these pieces of wood that all kind of pointed to the center. There was no crucifix. Mm-hmm. Well, this was very nice, and everybody liked it. But then, kind of the arch-conservatives just kept saying, where's the crucifix? Where's the crucifix? Well, the crucifix was over there by the tabernacle. Mm-hmm. It was the original crucifix they had when the parish was built in the early 60s. But they wanted it right behind the altar. And the pastor for many years resisted that, partly because he said, that artistry that was put up there by that artist, it's unethical to change it.
Yeah.
You should not change it. So finally, as a compromise, he went and purchased a risen Christ and put it in there. Because he said, he thought that honored what the artist intended. Mm-hmm. Okay. So that sat there for many, many years. Well, not many, many years. Another dozen years or so. And then that pastor retired, and the new pastor, who was from that conservative party, eventually put a new big crucifix. Not a big crucifix. One that even, it hung.
Over there.
It had a peg.
Like a flame.
Because you couldn't really put it against the wall, because the wall had, you know, had this wood, so it kind of hung out there. And it was part of, I think it's part of that tension between what's more important, the resurrection Christ or Christ on the cross.
Yes. I love it. It's just great. It's so great. I can't believe how great it is.
You know, some of the parents, we kind of lived through this whole tension in the Roman Catholic Church after, rising really after the
Vatican
II. When the dust settled after Vatican II, you know, it took about 10 years for it kind of like everything could settle. Then the sides began to form.
Yeah.
And we lived through the sides forming. Karen, my son's become confused. Why are you doing this? I explained, you know, you became a Catholic in 1990. Let me tell you, some of this stuff goes back, and it's wars that have been fought from how many years ago? Centuries. But I don't know how we get off onto this, but it's all becoming clear.
There's a lot of the really new Protestant churches that they don't even have crosses in them. They're trying to be so friendly, you know, to not to be
seeker sensitive
spaces.
Seeker sensitive. Yeah, we don't want to offend anybody, so let's not have any.
Exactly. Let's not have a cross in here, buddy.
No, let's go to chapter 6. I'm glad that Ignatius inspires all this conversation. He'd be pleased, believe me. Chapter 6, let no man be deceived. Even the heavenly beings and the glory of the angels and the rulers, visible and invisible, if they believe not in the blood of Christ, who is God, see how explicit he is about the divinity of Jesus, but at the same time he is explicit about the humanity by emphasizing the flesh of Jesus. Judgment awaits them also. He that receives, let him receive. Let not office puff up any man, for faith and love are all in all, and nothing is preferred before them. So even if a bishop or someone who has an office of church will tell you otherwise. Okay, verse 2, but know ye those who hold strange doctrine touching the grace of Jesus Christ, which came to us, how that they are contrary to the mind of God. I love that, strange doctrine. They have no care for love, none for the widow, none for the orphan, none for the afflicted, none for the prisoner, none for the hungry or thirsty. They abstain from Eucharist, that's thanksgiving, and prayer. Well, because it doesn't matter. Because anything that has to do with matter and material need is an illusion. So it doesn't matter. You don't have to take care of the poor. It doesn't matter. And you don't have to receive Eucharist. Because it's of matter. Because they allow not that the Eucharist is the flesh of our Savior. Notice that. Jesus Christ, whose flesh suffered because of our sins, and which the Father in his goodness raised up. You will see that Ignatius, and you'll see this in some of his other epistles, the Eucharist is literally the body and blood of Jesus. Another idea that wasn't created in the Middle Ages, it goes back to the second generation. It's quite amazing to me. Chapter 7. They, therefore, that dispute the good gift of God perish by their questionings. You can see he's lost his patience with his people. But if it were expedient for them to have love, that they may also rise, but it were expedient for them to have love, that they may also rise again. Okay.
So what's he saying there? So that they're willing to receive the love of Christ, but that's about it?
Well, they need the love of Christ. It's now only the love of Christ will save them.
Okay, I see.
Okay. That's how I would interpret it. It is therefore meet that we should, or proper, that we should abstain from such and not speak of them either privately or in public, but should give heed to the prophets and especially to the gospel, wherein the passion is shown unto us and the resurrection is accomplished. Chapter 8. But shun divisions as the beginning of evils. Do ye all follow your bishop as Jesus Christ followed the Father and the presbytery as the apostles, and to the deacons pay respect as to God's commandment. Let no one do aught of things pertaining to the church apart from the bishop. Let that be held a valid Eucharist which is under the bishop or one to whom he shall have committed it. In other words, only the bishop has the authority to celebrate the Eucharist or anyone the bishop would appoint. That is, the presbyters or priests that would come later. So you can see already he is emphasizing, and probably because of all the disorder and chaos that false teaching and the docetists were creating in the church, one of the responses was a much more authoritarian role for the bishop. So the bishops begin to take on more and more power and is held in high esteem in order to keep order and unity within the church. The downside of that, it led in later generations to bishops developing a quality that was quite authoritarian. That's the only, well, we see this beginning already very early, but that was the response of the church of the second generation to the chaos created by bad teaching. Wheresoever the bishop shall appear, there let the people be. Even as where Jesus may be, there is the Catholic Church. So there he is using that word Catholic. He's the first writer to use it. It is not lawful, apart from the bishop, either to baptize or to hold a love feast. But whatsoever he shall approve, this is well-pleasing unto God, that everything which ye do may be sure and valid. So for Ignatius, the bishop was the symbol of unity, and everyone needs to gather around the bishop, and all authority for ministry and service and the governance of the church flows from the bishop. So this is a very monarchical system he's advocating in order to bring unity and stability to the church. And it worked for centuries. It worked that way.
And agape, probably.
Yeah,
agape would be... A shared meal with that the agape meal kind of disappeared from practice.
When I was in high, after I graduated from high school, I don't know what I was doing. I'm trying to remember why I did this, but I used to bring all my cousins and everybody together to our house, and we'd have agapes.
There you go.
I would write the liturgy. I would do all the things, and we would have these prayer things. And I was like,
how cool was that? I wish I knew you back then.
I know. It's like,
were we in high school at the
that?
Same time?
Yeah. Well, we're about the same age. Yeah. I graduated in 1970 from Modern Day.
Okay.
And so it was in the early 70s. And so, but I just love that. I love that whole idea of coming together and, you know, I wanted to be a priest. And I don't know. It was like these weird things. But it was just fascinating to me how much... You know, how we needed to come together and share together and have prayer, but yet it was really beautiful.
Share
it was
meal.
Very sweet. Yeah, it was really neat. And my cousin just loved it. And I don't know what happened. I moved away and...
Well, in that time, back in the early 70s, I became involved in the Jesus People movement. And in that movement, we had Christian coffee houses. Everywhere. And there was one in Fullerton called My Brother's House, and I became a part of that, and we would have agape meals, or we'd get together and we'd have a shared meal with prayer. Yeah, it was kind of... Yes?
I think a couple things are going on back during Ignatius' time. One of the things is that the patriarchal structure that evolves in the church copies the patriarchal structure in Rome. In other words, there's a parallel between the need for order and roles of authority and all this sort of stuff, and it copies what was going on in Rome. So that's happening. The other thing that we don't hear here is there are varieties of ministries. There are pastors, there are teachers, there are people that are good at hospitality, there are people that speak in tongues and those who interpret tongues and all of that kind of language that we found in Paul We're not hearing that now, and this is like 30 years later. And part of it is, in my view, and this is Diane speaking, is that they're reining in the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
And one of the things that gets excluded as that reining in takes place is the function of women in the early church.
Yeah. Very good.
That's true.
I think
yeah.
that's very, very good observation. So we're moving around away from the community, our co-equals and participating ministry, and what we're getting is a professional class of leaders mm-hmm. in which they are the ones that have all of the gifts and ministries. Yeah. Which is an unfortunate development.
It's really kind of amazing how fast that happened.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
Very amazing.
Yeah. Valid well, Eucharist. I mean, that's.
I think we can't overemphasize the crisis the church was in when the last apostles died. Mm-hmm. Okay, and you can imagine chaos because there was no one to go to for the final word. Mm-hmm. So this is when the church, in being able to deal with this chaos, tried to bring order to it. And the way they brought order to it is, we're only going to recognize those leaders that were appointed by the apostles originally. And that those were the bishops. And then only recognizing those leaders who were appointed by those bishops. And very early you get apostolic succession. And it serves a very valuable function. It did preserve the church. But at the same time, the church lost a lot of its freedom. I think it's true. Women in ministry, they were eventually excluded from that. And this is when you see the gifts of the Holy Spirit functioning among, and the ministry of the laity greatly diminished, so the laity becomes more or less passive followers of the hierarchy. The hierarchy becomes and continues to become everything.
Well, and yeah. the idea here is that the Holy Spirit is funneled through the hands of the bishops.
Yeah.
And so you're presumably not going to be seeing the Holy Spirit working over here or working over here or working over here, because the Holy Spirit, the way the Holy Spirit functions is through the auspices of the bishops.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that happens. I mean, it just happened. And they were probably in a very tough spot. I mean, Jesus didn't come right back, and they thought it would, and
yeah.
it didn't. And, you
so
know, and then their first community of witnesses who really were witnesses of what was happening when Jesus was alive, and then with the crucifixion, resurrection, all that, they start passing away. So what, you know, where is this, what are we going to do? Where is it going?
Yeah, and your observation, Michael, is astute, because this is it does happen very early on. And you can see why it was necessary, mm-hmm. but at the same time, it was not without its cost. And the cost
sure.
was the sense of the spontaneity and the immediacy of the Holy mm-hmm. Spirit moving and working through the entire body of Christ.
That probably lost its community feel, I would
yeah.
think, as well.
So it became about obedience to the right authority, mm-hmm. which was the bishop. And let's look at, and we'll close with chapter 9, because you'll see this again coming along. It is reasonable henceforth that we wake to soberness while we have still time to repent and turn to God. It is good to recognize God and the bishop. Look at that. He that honoreth the bishop is honored of God. Do you see that? He that doeth aught without the knowledge of the bishop renders service to the devil. Yeah, this is very strong language. But this is a bishop who has been embattled with this teaching, this false teaching of docetism. So you can see where he's at. And now he's going to offer his life for that. So he's a courageous man. May all things therefore abound unto you in grace, for ye are worthy. Ye refreshed me in all things, and Jesus Christ shall refresh you. In my absence and in my presence ye cherished me. May God recompense you, for whose sake, if ye endure all things, ye shall attain unto him. And we'll stop there because we've run out of time. But we'll finish this epistle. And we'll start his epistle to the Romans next week. What do you think so far?
Oh, I love your
comments.
It's wonderful. That's just great.
Are you enjoying it?
Oh, yes.
Ignatius?
I really appreciate everyone's contributions to the discussion. It's just wonderful.
Yeah.
I'll go back to last year and listen to the dedicated thing. That would be interesting.
Oh, also. I'm sorry I wasn't here. I would have loved that one. I would have eaten that up like candy.
Yeah,
I think.
You would have. It was good.
Well, we can sit down and listen to it online.
Yeah,
have it
online.
Let's see. Everyone, this is Brother Bala, who is our guest from India.
Oh, welcome.
Any special intentions you would like to offer before we pray?
I would like to bring continued prayers for Mariah's family, for her father and for her nephew, and the conflict that's going on now over property. And it's causing a lot of upset in her family, and for Mariah too. She's very sad, so I pray for peace in that family.
Any other intentions? Well, let us present these intentions unto the Lord. Loving God, you fill all things, know all things. You're the giver of every good gift. We lift up our eyes to you, and we look to you, and we seek to find our refuge in you. For it is in your Son, Jesus, that we take refuge. And so we know that you are at work to answer our many prayers and our concerns. You are ever present, and you abide in our midst. With this knowledge, we are bold to pray in the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and the hour of our death. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. We belong to you.